Hello everyone, I'm Dr. Priya Sipaha. Today we are going to discuss abetment in Indian Penal Code Part 3. In my previous two videos, I have already explained the meaning of abetment and who is abettor, which is mentioned under section 107 and 108, 108A of IPC. In this video, I will explain some of the punishment pertaining to abetment. Because punishment is very lengthy part of abetment, that's why I am dividing this punishment into two videos. So this will be the first part of punishment. So let's start. Section 109 states that punishment of abetment if the act abetted is committed in consequence and where no express provision is made for its punishment. Now this particular section expresses basically three ingredients. First, there must be abetment to constitute any sort of illegal act or an offence. Secondly, whatever offence is being committed, that should be a consequence of the abetment. Thirdly, if there is no expressed provision is made in the code for the punishment of such offence under abetment, then whatever punishment is prescribed for the act, that will be the same punishment for the person who is abetting that act, similar to the person who is committing the act. Now, some of the illustration pertaining to section 109 of IPC. Basically, as I said, that whatever punishment is prescribed of that offense will be given to the person who is abetting another person to commit that offense. That offense could be of various level or in for various nature. It could be a bribe, it could be a murder, it could be theft, it could be grievous hurt. Any sort of offense. If a person is abetting another person for bribe, to give bribe to public servant, then the punishment will be is defined under section 161 of IPC. So the punishment will be similar to the person who is abetting and the person who is committing the offense. Similarly, if a person is abetting anyone for murder, then the punishment will be given to the person who is committing and the person who is abetting, the punishment prescribed under section 302 of IPC, and so on. Next is section 110, which is punishment of abetment if person abetted does act with different intention from that of abettor. Basically, section 110, 111, 112 and 113. These are the section which speaks about the liability of the abettor when the abetment has been done for the different offense and the commission of the offense is different. There are various situations. Now, in section 110, it states that the punishment of abettor, what will be the punishment of the abettor when the intention is different? Usually we say that the intention and the knowledge of the consequence and the nature of the act must be same of abettor and the person who is committing. But what happened if the intention is different, but the nature of the act is the same and the knowledge of the consequence is known to the abettor also and to the person who is committing to him also? In these condition, the punishment will be same. Here there is not at all any exceptions or any exemption for the intention, because the act which has been committed, that has been abetted by the person. Section 111 speaks about the liability of abettor when one act abetted and different act done. This is again the extension of section 110. In that section, it was only depend upon the intention. But here, the person who is abetting another person for certain type of offense, and that person has committed another offense, which that person abetted has not been directed or abetted. What happened? Whether the person who is abetting is liable for the act, which is not the act which he has abetted, or whether the person is not liable. Usually it is clear that the person is not liable, but there are certain probable consequences. That means these things is divided or depends upon the probability of certain consequences. Now, what are that probable consequences and how it is important for deciding the punishment? Now, there are three types of probability. If a person is abetted for a certain act and he has committed another act, the first example is if A has abetted B to give poison to C, and B misrepresent or misunderstand D as C, and he has given poison to D, with the consequence D dies, then whether A is responsible for the abetment of murder? Here A is responsible for the abetment of murder of D also, although he has given the direction or instigated B to murder C, but still he will be liable because there is a probability of this type of consequences. Now, second probability, whether it comes under the definition of probability or not. By any chance, if A has instigated B to burn the house of C, and B with the result of abetment burn the house of C, but when he was setting a fire in the house of C, he also committed theft. Now, in this condition, whether the person who has abetted to set fire or to burn the house of C is responsible for theft also? No, because there is no probable consequences. And if there is no probable consequences, then the person who has abetted to burn the house, he will be only guilty of abetment of burning the house. But the person who has committed both the offenses, that means he not only set the fire in the house but also committed theft, he will be responsible for both the offense. Now, the third condition. Now, the third is if A has instigated or abetted B that he should do a robbery with his gang in C house, and with the consequences of the abetment C, B along with his gang went to C house with the intention to commit robbery. And during the robbery, if any person tries to stop it, then if any of the person who is a part of a gang of B, he kill any person or any housemate of C house, then B will be not only guilty of committing robbery but also for the murder. Similarly, A will be guilty of abetting for robbery and abetment of murder, because here there is a probable consequence. That particular offense is likely to commit. That's why A will be liable for abetment of not only robbery but also for murder. So this is called the probable consequence, and the punishment and liability of the abettor will be decided on the probability. Now, next is section 112, which states that abettor, when liable to cumulative punishment for act abetted and for act done. Now, this section states that if the act for which the abettor is liable under the last preceding section is committed in addition to the act abetted and constitute a distinct act, the abettor is liable to punishment for each of the offense. Here also probability is important. that if a person is awaiting any other person to do some certain act and with the consequences, if he knew that there is a probability of certain another act also, and that act is performed, is committed, then not only the person who is committing the act is liable for both the act, but also the person who is abating, no matter for a certain act, he will be liable for both the act, and there will be cumulative punishment for the act abated and for the act done. For example, if A instigated B to resist by force a distress made by the police public servant, B in consequence to resist the distress, in offering the resistance, B voluntarily causes grievous hurt to the public servant, and also he has resisted the distress. In these cases, he will be liable for both the act committing. The first one is to resist the distress, and the second one is to give a grievous hurt voluntarily to public servant. And the person who has abetted, he will also be liable for the cumulative punishment of the act which has been committed and which is directed, which has been abetted also, because there is a clear possibility of that act. Now, section 113. This speaks about the liability of abettor for an effect caused by the act abetted different from the intended by the abettor. Basically, section 110, 111, 112 and 113. These section explains and describe the liability of the abettor in the different level, in the different forms, where they have been abetted for the different act, but they have performed a different act. In these conditions, whether the person who has abetted, whether he is liable or not. Section 111 and 112 I have already explained, and in 113 also. It is clearly mentioned that if the person is abetting another person for a certain act, but the act has been done differently, then the liability will be only in that condition if there is again a probable consequences. That means if certain act which has been committed is likely to commit it, then there will be, the abettor will be guilty of that act which has been committed, no matter it is different from the act which for which he has abetted. Section 114 speaks about the abettor present when offense is committed. Now, in the previous section, it is described that abetment, it is not at all necessary in abetment that the person who is abetting must be present where the any particular act has been committed by the consequence of the abetment. But if by any chance abettor is present at that moment, it may happen that the thing or the offense for which the abettor is abetting another person, that person wants a help how to commit that act. And if abettor is present there and he is continuously instigating, guiding, provoking or doing a continuous job of abetment at the time of the commencement of the act, then at that level he is definitely liable for the act which has been committed by the another person by the guidance or instigation of that person continuously, and that person is present there. 115, which says about abetment of offense punishable with death or imprisonment for life if offense not committed. Now, this is a situation where abetment has been done for a certain act and that act is serious in nature, because for that act the punishment is either the death or life imprisonment. Maybe that act is murder, for example. That means if a person is abetting another person to commit murder of anyone else, now if that act is not committed, whether the person who is abetting is liable for the act of murder or not. In these circumstances or in this type of situation, there is again two types of probability. In first case, if there is an abetment for murder That means a serious offense for which the punishment is either the death or life imprisonment, and that act has been not done. Then this type of punishment is not prescribed generally. Whether if there is no act, then there is no punishment generally. But if the offense is serious in nature, for which the punishment is death and imprisonment for life, no matter that has not been committed, but the person who has abetted that act, which is serious in nature, will be punished for 7 years with fine. And in second circumstances or second situation, if again the person is abetted another person to commit murder, then by any chance there is no murder, but the person gets a serious injury. And if there is any hurt or injury or grievous hurt, then there will be a punishment for life imprisonment. That means for 14 years. So if there is no injury, no harm and no offense, but the abetment is serious in nature for the offense, then there will be 7 years of punishment. And if there is any attempt has been made, and in the consequences the person is injured, then the punishment will be 14 years with fine. So this is the end of part 3 of abetment in the Indian Penal Code. In this video I have explained punishment, the first part of punishment, because punishment is lengthy. So I have explained punishment starting from section 109 to section 115. In my next video I will explain starting from section 116 to 120. That will be all for abetment. So, hope you like the video, and if you like it, please do not forget to hit the like button and subscribe my channel. If you want the detailed notes, you may visit to my website, that is priyasapaha.com, and you may also follow me on FB page, that is Law Colloquy, Twitter, Dr. Priya Sapaha, Instagram, Law Colloquy, and YouTube, Dr. Priya Sapaha. Thank you for watching. See you soon. Bye-bye.